Good morning, friends. Today, thanks to the director of the institute, Dr. Rao, for inviting me to be here. And very importantly, we have Dr. Padmaraju, also Dr. Ramarao. In the morning, we had Dr. Siddiq and Dr. Prabin Rao. And we have also other colleagues from different institutes, directors from DRR, from poultry research, and others. And my colleagues from the institute. And very importantly, the provisioners of the 109th foundation course on agriculture research management. This is one institution where every provisioner has to come and then experience. And I see your experience is also very good. You say it's a different environment and also very inspiring environment. And that is something which is a positive for me to take home back, that NAM has created a positive environment for the provisioners. So Dr. Rao, so this is the statement of the FOCARS and should be noted. And of course, credit goes to not only the leader, but also all the faculty members for creating that environment of positivity in NAM. Because anyone who is new, and the impression is very, very important for him or her. The impression is that there is a positive environment here, and that's a big plus for not only NAM, for all of ICAR. And Dr. Rao was telling me not only that the FOCARS are telling, there are forest officers who came here and there are other people who come here and they go with this positivity, a sense of that positive environment and excellent environment in every sphere is prevailing at NAM. So, you know, I was telling yesterday director of the Meat Institute that we are not able to sell that. We are very poor salespersons. So NAM as an institution, how good it is doing, how best it has done. So I believe, Dr. Rao, there should be a scope to sell this. So the first advice is to you, while appreciating what you are doing, that probably we should take advantage of these appreciations that we receive from various quarters and highlight those in different forms and putting our own intellectual inputs into it and describing different formats and highlighting and publishing them. So I think that should be the first and foremost objective of our institutional leadership. So I keep every time coming and then doing advising something, but you are the one who very meticulously follow those and translate those into action, and that is what is visible. So this is one. I think we are doing already, but I think there's more we should do. And we should capitalize on our strengths. And we have tremendous strength. How do we capitalize? Can we also send a proposal to the IAS Academy to send their people here, the probationers, so that they go to different institutes? The Honorable Cabinet Secretary was telling he went to Punjab Agricultural University for exposure, so those days. So, and he still appreciates the university. So those impressions are carried till their retirement. So I think this is one which we can do this proposal, and with what all we can impart in terms of exposure to IAS provisioners, or even the IRAs, even police service and forest service. They're coming. Forest service, you said they came. But others, if we can have a structured kind of program, and 1 day, 2 day, 3 day, 4 day, whatever you feel confident, and write to them that they should know that such and such things are existing. And in addition to scientist provisioners coming here, if they come and then learn, so that will be a good thing. So that will be a good step during our tenure to actually promote. So that's the second one, rather part of the past suggestion. That we can, and they, when they are in service, they will not forget it. That is something called NAM, and this is the kind of environment when they stay here and go around and see the facilities and see the kind of topics being covered. And for instance, leadership building. I keep telling that we have program on building leadership. How they should be the leaders of tomorrow. And not the political leaders, but leaders in their own field. So also, you know, there are other things. I'll come to those later. So this is to start with. So while sitting, you know, when everybody says that you give a text of your presentation, I said I don't come prepared with the presentation. And I don't think what I have to talk. I only see the situation and speak. And today, after seeing you, that you started praising me, so that part I'll leave. And the rest of the things I'll talk. I see that majority of you are doing PhD, not completed PhD. 27 of you, I may be wrong, but close to that. And only 5 were, you know, with PhD. So it's a large number doing PhD. And next time, in this year, 2019, so MSc candidates would not be eligible to write ARS examination. So only PhD, and you are lucky that you have joined, and those who are selected are also lucky, and subsequently, only PhD persons will be eligible. In fact, UGC has made this mandatory. They will be implementing from 2021, and we will be implementing from 19. And next examination, whenever it comes, whether 19 or 20 or whatever. So that will be the kind of, you know, condition, eligibility criteria. And we have very consciously done this. You know, you might ask me why. And this is one of the reforms. We have almost done, you know, 50, 60 important reforms. And we are bringing out a document. And the reforms in ICAR, what we have done in past 3 years. And some of them are having very far-reaching, you know, impacts. So this is one. Why I say, because you should also know, because you might have questions why, you know, PhD. You yourself face a lot of inconvenience when you come with MSc. Because, you know, you have to go back and then be there somewhere to continue your PhD and spend time. So in the process, first 5 years of your research life, which is so important to establish yourself as a researcher. And that's what, you know, I did. For 10 years, I didn't go for any training. I didn't go anywhere. And in fact, I trained maybe several hundred people without undergoing any training in my own area of specialization during those 10 years. And why I say so, that if you focus on developing one field, it takes time. And if you do that, then you are leader in that field. So nobody else on earth can beat you because you have developed the field. You know what the ins and outs of the area. And, you know, and you are established. So 5 to 10 years of your initial life, if you spend here and there and dhakka kha ke idhar udhar parishan hoke bhagoge, so obviously you can't establish yourself. And when you don't establish in initial years, In subsequent years, you only become a person to criticize the system and lost somewhere, and in the process you don't contribute anything and become so frustrated and only look after your own family and yourself, and that's it. So as a scientist, you completely lose your identity. And you only do a job to earn your living. That's what many people do. And I believe, and today is the day not to do that, to have a resolve not to do that, but to establish yourself as a scientist who is actually recognized as a scientist. So you are basically a scientist, and you should establish yourself as a scientist. How do you do that? So your plan of action should be ready from here. Before leaving from this institute, you are telling artificial intelligence, your plan of action should be ready from here. Nobody on earth can. I tell you, the kind of freedom ICAR provides, no other organization provides. No other organization provides the kind of freedom. So you will realize when you join another organization, that's the reason why people from other organizations, they join and then leave that and come to ICAR. People have gone to bank and come to ICAR. You know, I wrote the civil service main exam and I dropped that to be in science and, to be a scientist. And that's what, my colleague keep telling. And, so there are plenty of scope to actually do, explore, innovate, and then establish yourself. So that's the first thing I will say. So that is one point, that why we have taken the decision that it should be PhD. For your own sake, that once you complete, and I tell you, PhD is the most crucial phase in your life. In a hurry, if you do something for the sake of getting a degree because you have to join, or because you have to go back and do something in a hurry and then just for the sake of submitting a thesis and getting a degree, that is a big blunder in life. PhD is the period where you can peacefully do your excellent work and publish at least 3-4 public papers in international journals of repute, and there you establish yourself as a researcher, as a scientist. And we don't do, because we get disturbed. There is an exam and you write the exam and then get selected and come here and then, training here and there, subject matter, this and that, and then when you go back to the institute, you are not happy, and then you have all complaints and then you are lost. The life is gone. So your PhD, which must have provided the first kick to you as a scientist, is gone. The kind of research, the quality of research you were supposed to do in PhD is gone. The kind of learnings that you must have during PhD is gone. Because you, subsequently when you start your career, you like to plan your experiment, you haven't learned it properly. If you don't learn properly, how do you plan your experiment? What should be the method? There, that is where we commit blunders. We don't use appropriate method to answer the question that we are asking. So we are lost. Because we don't have any learnings. We don't learn anything there in that phase. So we are in a hurry. We just complete coursework and do something here and there and then leave it halfway and then come and then go back and do. So I don't blame you that you are here. But you have this difficulty. A job is important. You can't deny that. Nobody can deny the job is not important. You can't do this. So that's the reason why you have applied and you are here. Perfectly all right. But at the same time, if you look at the other side, so you have difficulty. So we have taken this. And then the other point is that the whole world is moving in that direction. You know, outside world, if you see that you are going to remain as a scientist, the scientist without PhD has very little sense and meaning in today's context, globally, and so also nationally. So PhD is a must. Gone are those days that you can do MSc and then roam around and then, for your own promotion, you need this. And if you have PhD, someone rightly said that we need to go for postdoc. And then you can immediately plan, because 2 years of probation, and then you can plan for a kind of postdoc, maybe 1 year. There are plenty of opportunities. And we have initiated a postdoc program for 10 people, 10 or 20 people, I think.
Total
10.
50.
No, not that. You know, our in-house postdoc at IRI has some. 30, probably 30. IRI has some, and some only deemed universities. And some number we have initiated. So anyone after completing this would like to come for as a postdoc within the country in the institution of, you know, relevance. So most welcome. And outside, now we are going to do this from the next plan, that sending people, our own people, as a postdoc. So for PhD, it's already there. Netaji Subhas fellowship is already there. But postdoc, we are going to have some fellowship, and so that we send our own people for postdoc. And now we have introduced inside the country, in our own institutions, IRI 10, I think other institutions, some number. So exactly, I don't remember. So we have done this. And for abroad also, we'll do this. And we are alive to that situation, and we appreciate that suggestion whosoever gave. And you know, that is what we are going to do. So there are other regions. If I describe only, I take whole time for that. And this is something which is sometimes is heartening, and happy to see that 26 out of 32 are from IRI. And but then when I looked at, that's the reason why I wanted your introduction. You know, it's not just that you IRI, maybe you have spent 1 or 2 years, that's it. So, but you are coming from many different universities. So that is what is very, very satisfying. And anybody from Karnataka? And US Bangalore or Dharwad? Both of you. So Dharwad used to do pretty good, but now it has gone down. And so that's worrisome. And anybody from Kerala Agriculture University? So two are there.
Three are there.
And TNAU? Two are there. Two and three. And Haryana Agriculture University? One is there. And PAU? One is there. So I think JB Pant, 4, 5 are there. And so there are few universities. Raipur? You are there. One or two each from institutions. Jammu Kashmir, two of the institutes, anyone? None of them. Rajasthan Agriculture University, any one of them?
Yes.
From?
MPU.
MPU. Two are there. And Gujarat? None. And Maharashtra?
Three
are there. Okay. So this is the structure, and why I'm asking this, because I go to every university to deliver convocation address and also interact with the people, and that's a message I would carry through these universities to address the problems what they are confronting, and then when I see the kind of structure with regard to gender, it's almost 50-50. And so that's what we want, at least 30% we say, but then you are already more than 40, close to 45, maybe. And so that's a good representation. I'm extremely happy to see, and that gender balance is already restored, and though there were distortions, and it was said that I have been coming to this, how many batches?
Seven
batches. I have been addressing people here, the youngsters, and listening to you and what all you say, and also at the same time going back with a message that there is certain degree of satisfaction prevailing, but a great deal of discontent still there in many areas. And that needs to be really addressed. And if I have to come back to those points, certainly, the kind of funds which is required for research. The other day, you know, I met one, you know, tall personality, you know, and he was inquiring why, you know, there is little fund available for, you know, we need some reform. You know, ICAR was reviewed by a very eminent committee, the ex-secretary, DST, and then they have given report. So we are analyzing for implementation. So we were also reviewed, ASRB was also reviewed, and ASRPs were reviewed, and then our performance is being reviewed, and National Academy of Science was reviewed by us. And you know, almost five, six reviews, important reviews happened during this period. Everybody, and KVKs were reviewed and graded, and so we were reviewed. Why? Because everybody is judging us for our performance. And they think that ICAR is too big, the organization, and is wasting money and not delivering. You know, that's the kind of perception people, you know, have, that they're not delivering as much that they should deliver. And you all know that how many institutions, KVKs, universities, and universities are growing in number. So obviously when someone looks at it and feels that it is too big a system, and obviously it might be consuming a huge amount of money. The other day, the DG, you know, CSIR and myself were on a dinner table, we were discussing. And when I said that my total budget including salary is 7,800 crore. And out of 7,800 crore, 65% goes as a salary. So you can imagine what is left. So only 30-35% left for research. And out of that research budget, what is so-called research budget, you have, you know, the capitals. You have always repairing, maintenance is a big one, particularly the old institutions. And then you have new constructions coming up here and there. And, you know, also we are giving funds to the universities for building of a variety of facilities. And so on and so forth, almost 300-350 crores we provide to the university for building different infrastructure facilities every year. So this is the kind of thing. So obviously, the money for actual research available is relatively very less. But when I said that only one of my variety, that is Pusa Basmati 1121, those who are from IRI know this, that Pusa Basmati 1121, the longest grain ever in the world, that gives, by way of export, gives 15,000 crore rupees as a return to this country. 15,000 crore rupees. The potato varieties which are grown, the potato varieties, you know, these hisabs were not available. I have done, got it done recently. The potato varieties which are grown in this country, which were developed by CPRI Simla, the total, the gross value generated by these varieties are 54,000 crores. 54,000 crores. And past 3 years, the sugarcane variety CO238 has given us billions of rupees, and several thousand crores, I don't remember the figure now, several thousand crores as additional benefit to the farmers. And very importantly, and this has gone, this has contributed to enhance production of sugar to the tune of 32 million tons, and we require just 25 million tons. And we do not know what to do with this sugar. And that's the reason why the government has taken decision to produce bioethanol from sugarcane. Sugarcane juice is going to be diverted. This is a policy decision based on the technology developed by ICAR. So that's the, you know, if I keep counting, so, you know, it will take time. And likewise, you know, I am documenting contributions and sending to everybody concerned. And that was the biggest block which was available, and contributing to the thought process that the ICAR is not doing much. And you know, now I prepared a document on entrepreneurship, and you know, particularly the agri startups, the conclave that we had, Nam participated and contributed. Srinivas should be somewhere here, you know, was there for 4 or 5 days, maybe a week time to host this. And that document I have sent to everywhere, you know, PMO, the cabinet secretary, and everybody. And the appreciation letters have started coming that, you know, it's very good. So what I'm telling that, you know, the kind of activities which we are doing and promoting and then informing people is so important in today's context. And so this is very much essential. So I was talking about funds and diverted to this. So my fund is 7,800 crores and 65% also goes to salary and including your salary. So you should not forget that you are getting salary also. And that's also very important. You must get salary. And if you don't get salary, so obviously, and you don't forget that we are 20,000 staff in ICAR. So 19,000 plus staff in ICAR, all categories. And we are reviewing everything. The cadre strength of scientists is reviewed, cadre strength of administration is reviewed, cadre strength of technical is being reviewed, the cadre strength of AAAs is already reviewed. So we have review, we have tremendous amount of review we have done during this period. So everything is reviewed now and these are being finalized. Our scientists, very important criteria which we used, that our ratio of principal scientists to senior scientists to scientists would be 1:2:8. So your number is going to increase further. And you will be the class in the ICAR who will be calling the shot. And you are so important. And it will be a pyramid which has a very broad base, and scientists will be, you know, every institute will be full of scientists now. And that is how we want more, research output from the scientists. So they should be provided every. So coming to more funding for research, so what is our plan of action? Number one, that the institutions have to actually address this very carefully. I'll cite one example. That I gave 20 crores to IRI for actual research, but 10 at the institute level, 10 was diverted for repair and maintenance, and what was left is only 10 crores for institute like IRI. And similarly, and I do fine, and this year I gave operational and working expenditure, you know, almost 100 crore, and out of that 43 was diverted for pension and other things. And this directors, I believe all those directors who are sitting here, they have to carefully see this, that money which goes for research and operational expenses, they must be utilized for that. And what is done at the finance person level, and you blindly sign, and that's what I see in some of the institutions, actual money available for operational research operations are left very little, and money is diverted, and you just blindly sign without questioning the finance. And anybody from finance who is sitting here must take note of this and then see that after due consultation with the director, he must do this. Without that, he must not touch. So directors have to kindly look into it, that how money, when it is allotted a particular amount to an institute and to a particular head, how it is changing heads at the institute level, or within head there are sections, and among sections how it is distributed, logically or illogically, this is what has to be done very critically, so that we have enough money available for research. I can tell you, the money for research has never declined, and never declined. At no point in time it has declined. But this diversions to different activities has increased, and primarily because of lack of control at the institute level. And that appears that we have less money for the research work. And also the second one, which I see, that the directors at their own level, that some of them, they have their own labs and they divert majority amount of money to their own labs without distributing to the scientists and giving to, you know, evenly, and having some criteria for money distribution at the institution level. And that puts artificial deficiency situation and imposed. There are scientists coming to me, in fact, complaining about it, that some directors are actually eating away most of the funds for their own labs, and biased distribution and is happening at the institute level. And that is another, which has come to my notice. And, that's the reason why artificial, situation is being created. The third one is that we have to prioritize. When I say that, we don't do at the institute level, and we include every small idea as a priority work in the process that, working on those and spending money, we can't afford that. We have to prioritize and provide funds accordingly. Priority 10 might be there, but it has to be less funded. So my priority 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 has to receive maximum funds, and that is what is not happening accurately. So democracy is fine, but democracy in research will be disastrous. And if you just evenly distribute your money to everybody, so obviously it will not work. So your priority areas have to be defined and very clearly, and it should be open for everybody. It's not that director decides my lab and my work is number one priority, so I'll divert all my money to my own lab, not the other ones. So it should be done at the institutional level, at the higher level, so that everybody knows about it, so that money is actually distributed properly, and it's based on certain criteria. See, when we say that laboratory facilities and all that, it's related to funding, more funding for research, and we have old equipments and then you don't have adequate facilities. I can tell you, when I look at the EFC documents, my director friends keep writing, and obviously this is coming from their colleagues, keep writing the same equipment in every EFC. So basically not applying minds, what is actually required to build the institution and having that futuristic idea that what needed to be actually built for next 10 years. And without that, obviously you don't have any new thing added, and also the old ones, which one to be actually replaced, the one which is required more, or randomly write only PCR machines and only spectrophotometers, or something, keep repeating. And this is what bothers me, and that's the reason why we have taken the decision that lab in Hyderabad is open for any scientist in the ICAR system, and that we have created now in every institution. This is all in the website, is all available. In ICAR website is also now available. So every lab of any institute, wherever it is located, it belongs to whole of ICAR. No control and over. Labs in any institution. So that is what we have done, and we will now open it up, and anybody sitting anywhere. So that is the locational disadvantage that you say. You're posting in a remote area. So in today's context, there is no remote area. In today's context, there is no remote area. Every area is so well connected now. Major institutions are located in very well, very good places, and they're very well connected. And when I say that if you want to do something and facilities available at IRI, you go and work there. No one is going to tell you no. And we are going to create more common facilities. At IRI, we are creating a discovery center or innovation center where all facilities will be available, open for everybody. And anybody who wants to go there has an innovative idea. An innovative idea will be selected, and a committee will do that. And anybody can go and sit there and work for 1 year, 2 years, and 3 years, or 5 years, can do their work there, and getting salary from the respective institutions. So we are creating that institution and facility there. So centralized facility for everything, that you can go and discover something and innovate on something if you have a novel idea to play on. And I believe many youngsters will be coming out with such ideas. So already 10 o'clock, I haven't actually started what I wanted to speak. So there are quite a bit of things to speak about. So, and every institute laboratory would be converted to that kind of, one, so that there is no question of you not having the facility. You need not have in your institution. Anywhere it is, you have a right to utilize it. So if you don't get it, you write to me. After your joining, if you don't get that, you want to work in from some university, even the Prime Minister's office instructed us that the facility available anywhere, even in CSR system, has to be open for everybody. So this is the kind of mechanism which is going to be in place, and that we have already discussed at the highest level, and we are going to implement this shortly. So this has been created, DST has created, in fact University of Mumbai has created the platform, and DST has advised everybody of CSIR, ICAR, everybody follow the pattern, so that facility available anywhere is available for everybody. So that would not be a limitation. So even if you don't have funds at the institution level to create the facility, so it will be available elsewhere in the system or even outside the system to work on. So what is that limiting? Limiting is the idea. You have to play with the idea. Do you have the idea? And that is, today's world requires that idea. So you must go with this message that what idea I have, how superior this idea is, how intellectually appealing this idea is, how competitive this idea is globally, not just locally and then all that, globally. Or if you are going to solve the local problem, it's okay. That's also important. So you have to have that idea to play around, to establish yourself as someone, to be reckoned with, to be described, to be celebrated. And that is what is actually required. And this is the time. Take a deep breath. 5 minutes, you are doing some meditation in the morning. And the last, New Year Day at IRI, I was telling this. And some people have different ideas, because don't want to do, because when you are matured with certain ideas, so you very difficult to change. We say farmers are not changing. The scientists are the toughest ones to change, actually. Because there's a hardened ideas and concepts in their mind. They're very difficult to change. My extension people who are sitting here, they can try on scientists, how easily they can change scientists and how easily they can change farmers. The attitude change is the biggest task in extension, and how you can change the attitude of scientists. Once they become scientists and have certain ideas, they think they know everything and they don't have to do anything, and they start criticizing everybody and every idea. So what I was telling is, take a deep breath and think what you want. Decide, and also that deep breathing will give you new ideas. And keep doing deep breathing and you'll get new ideas. And why we discovered zero? We discovered so many things, but nothing comes now. Because we have forgotten those principles which were then practiced, and today we are all in air. We are all in air. We are not grounded. The day we are grounded, and then we'll start thinking. The originality will come in. That originality is suppressed in all of us. That originality is suppressed in all of us. And that gets manifested and gets fully expressed when you are, removed from those shackles of the ordinary thinking and the distractions of the so-called world that we are surrounded by. And when you get rid of those shackles and you are free, then only your original thinking will come out, and you will be able to express yourself, and your potential will manifest. The tremendous potential, which all would remain latent till we retire. Till we retire. All our potential will remain latent till we retire. So how do we actually allow that? We have great sayers and philosophers saying many things, and you know better and you can read those. But how do you unshackle yourself and your own thought process so that it freely flows out of you? Now that is what is actually required. Free flowing of ideas from yourself, and so that you grow. And how do you grow and manifest your inner being as a human being? And also someone was telling that we should work more for farmers, and lab to land must happen, and lab to land will happen, and effortlessly it will happen, because that becomes your duty, your responsibility. We don't understand that. We think it is my naukri, the job to go for doing something in the field. When I say that this is my duty, I am duty bound to do that. Not just because I am paid for it, but because I have a responsibility to the society to do. Then everything will be all so smooth. And that is the reason why things don't happen as much they should happen in the field situation. Lab to land, we have plenty of things. And why things are not going? Because of such mindsets that we have inherited over a period of time. So friends, certainly there are plenty of things to talk about, and initial funding is a good idea, that one scientist joins, he should be given some amount, maybe 2 lakhs or 5 lakhs, and the CSIR gives about 5 lakhs or so, and we will now bring out a circular, so this should be action point, that will give all freshers some money, at least 1 lakh, 2 lakh to start with, so that they start establishing themselves, doing something, and you know, and also the other is the kind of foreign tour. That's a good idea, good suggestion, and we'll see that so many people are distributed into 2-3 sections and sending them to good a particular location, and you can see the IAS pattern if they have something of that sort.
Yes.
And how do they do, and why we cannot send to a good lab in Cold Spring Harbor or in MIT or Harvard or whatever, Caltech or whatever, so, or in you know, some labs in USDA where plenty of, or even other lands, Wageningen University or in Australia and CSIRO somewhere, so we can find out in China, Chinese Academy of Science or whatever institute, and Beijing Genomics Institute, and you have plenty of those, and then we can see, and whatever investment is required, we'll do that, and that should be inbuilt in your own budget, Dr. Rao.
Yes.
And so we will initiate this. So two major decisions we have taken based on your own suggestions, right? So you should take credit for that and clap for yourself. And collaboration with other sister departments, a very good idea. And we just signed, you should see the website, we just signed the MOU with DBT. And I have been doing this for past 3 years. Can you imagine? I talked to them, the then Secretary Vijay Raghavan, and sent the draft, and then he worked on those at his side. And MOU is ready for past 1 year to be signed, more than a year. And the meantime, he also left, and then new secretary joined, and yes, he also took time to understand the whole thing. And then, you know, finally, we signed. And once that is there, and we are building about 8 to 10 programs, and you can count one, that we'll have facilities, lab facilities open. Anywhere it is in DBT Institute, it's as good as our facility. So that's what we are going to do. It's one, you know, in the MOU. And the second one, that you like to work there in any of the institutes, so you can go and work there. And the third, that you know, the research programs, whatever you want to build, jointly will build in frontier areas of science, and so that there is no problem. And we want to have more of you know, agri entrepreneurs. The BIRAC is going to advertise for us and also provide funding about 30 lakhs each. You know, at least to start with. In fact, they were talking in crores, and they will provide that to the you know, startups, and we will incubate in our incubation centers, the 25 of them. So we will incubate, and we will handhold. Our ideas will be there, and those will be advertised, the challenge areas, and they will be coming. And that's the kind of understanding we have agreed. And you know, I have asked Dr. Saxena, ADG IPTM, to prepare a document for that, and we'll do that. So likewise, and similarly, CSIR, I have been following for almost 2 years now, and earlier DG retired, the new DG, and he is trying to understand the document, and they are all driven by ICAR, you must remember, and you know, and that's one we are going to sign, and they want to release their varieties through our system, most welcome. So they are developing some variety in Mentha, for instance. We have AICRP on medicinal plants, and they will be introducing their plants in our AICRP system, and we will be evaluating if they are good only, because otherwise they are promoting their varieties without knowing their worth, actually. So that is how it is going to happen. And similarly, there are many other areas in biotechnology, particularly transgenics, GM, you know, we have some programs. So this is going to happen. And ISRO, yes, you know, we had already discussion going on for pretty long time. And, you know, the earlier, you know, space chairman, Dr. Kiran Kumar, we had a discussion, he retired, you have a new one. So these transitions are, actually taking more time. So we will go into it, and these are all building up. And this is an ICMR. Immediately after my joining, the then DG, Soumya Swaminathan, so because she came from Dr. Swaminathan family, so obviously she had that orientation. And we signed the MOU in just a few months' time. We prepared it and signed it. And we have common programs on zoonoses, common programs on antimicrobial resistance, common programs are biosafety, particularly the pesticide residues, and so on and so forth. There are 4 or 5 areas we have common programs and which have been developed. So likewise, so we are, although now, we're launching a program with Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. And that is for modernization of bidding programs. Some of you are plant bidders would appreciate that. All digital, and very high throughput ones. And that is what we are going to do, and we are going to launch on 25th, and they are providing almost 25-30 crore rupees, and to train our own scientists from the system. We have chosen 5-6 crops and AICRPs to be modernized completely, and we'll translate that into the other bidding programs. Our bidding programs in 5 years' time is going to be completely transformed with the help of Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. And so also many other things which are happening. If I describe, it will take several hours to really complete this. And obviously, the posting, which is a concern for all of you, and I strongly believe that should be your concern. And when I was like you here, every one of us and myself bothered where I'll be posted. And wherever is vacancy, you will be posted. So that is the fundamental understanding. And if you are top in the list, in the merit list, obviously you will get as per your choice. And if you are there a little below, so obviously you can discuss among yourselves and you can have adjustments and all that. And then accordingly you can give your choice and we will place you. And mostly we go by your choice. And mostly you get first choice. Majority of you get first choice, the choice, first one. And some of you get maybe second. Hardly anybody gets the third choice. And you don't go beyond third choice. That has been happening previously. But at the same time, as I said, no place is a disadvantageous location. The second one I must tell you, that we have kept it open 5 years. If you serve well and do wonderful job, and satisfy and establish yourself as a good scientist, and you have all right to get yourself transferred, and transfer cycle would operate. So after 5 years, nobody can tell you don't apply, right? Even if at many cases we have overruled the directors, even though they say that no, we have actually transferred them. Because given the situation, not that in every case, given the situation. So you will be transferred to a better location or whatever location of your choice. And so this is the principle. So don't think that, if you are working in Northeast and you have a bound responsibility to work there. You are bound by that and you are signing that you can be posted anywhere and you agree to that. So you have no right to say that I will not go to that place or this place or I have a choice. But at the same time, because you have a merit, you have your own choice and you go by that. So if there is no vacancy and you want that you should be posted at IRI or IIHR, we can't do that because there is no vacancy. So obviously you would appreciate this, that we are supporting you because you go by your choice, but we can't place you somewhere where there is no vacancy, obviously. So that's the reason why be satisfied, whatever posting you get, and try to do something. I must tell you, the Northeastern Hill Region Institute in Barapani. That was a place, 20 years, 30 years ago, the travel from Guwahati to that place was so difficult. But today, I imagine people who worked those days at that place, they all came out so successful because that ecology provided challenges to work on. The kind of research they did and kind of publications they brought out, that placed them on a higher pedestal. And they came and here occupied a DDG, vice chancellors, directors, even today. Even today, there are several directors and vice chancellors who actually, you know, were one day working there at the Barapani Institute. So difficult places have their own advantage. And if you do small work, meaningful work, publish it well, and without wasting your time roaming around how to get transfer behind a politician, putting all kind of pressure, I can tell you, during past 3 years, we have not listened to any politician. We have not listened to any political pressure in transfer and posting. And that's the reason why all letters regarding transfer and posting has stopped. I used to get in the first year, and when this system came in, the automatic one, the computerized system, and afterwards, no recommendations from any quarter for transfer and posting of scientists. Nothing. So that one reform which we did, that the transfer and posting would be all computerized and correct criteria is fixed, and if you put a wrong criteria and you are caught, so your marks will be deducted by us. Computer might be befooled, but we can't be befooled. So don't do that. So if you have to have for a transfer medical certificate and board has to do that, and without that you are applying and trying to cheat us, so that you will be cheated actually. So anyway, so that's the kind of thing. And you have said few other things, and I don't have time to actually do that. And I have several points to speak. I'll take another, it's already 10:20, so never mind, I'll take another 10 minutes, Dr. Rao. So I believe my ticket is now postponed. Let's find out. Dr. Rao, Pravin Rao. Just ring Dr. Rao, whether it is postponed. So friends, I was talking about some reforms. We have done quite a bit. ASRB is reformed, you know, and our chairman is already selected. This is ACC approval which is going to happen. And members are already selected, and we are going to have shortly by end of January or the most 15th of February, the board reconstituted. And you know what kind of changes happened. Chairman for 7 years? Is somebody has doing something wrong, continue doing for 7 years? So now only 3 years. Do whatever you want to do, 3 years. Finished. In such positions, you can't have people, you know, sitting there for a very long time and, and have their own way of working and then imposed on the system. So that's what is a big, big change. And so quickly we have to find after 3 years have another chairman, but doesn't matter. The process should start before. So that is one big change we have done. And also ICAR was controlling many ways, and ICAR has many suggestions and do this and do that. So now ICAR's control is gone. So only their control is there. So directly. So nothing, they should listen to ICAR and then be influenced by ICAR. And not necessarily they will have DG in their board also. They can do selection on their own. DG will not have any say that I want this and that. So they can do away with that. That's the proposal. So that depends on them. And similarly, there are many other things we have introduced, and quite a bit of reforms, so I don't want to really go into those, but you know that the kind of areas that I would like to, you know, you to really ponder, that's the last part of my presentation, and
done?
Yeah. So this is 6 o'clock, no? So, I have 1 more hour, so but I'll not spend here. I have plenty of things to do. So, you should be also set free. Not shackled by DG for 2 hours here. And then forced to sit here. So, friends, last year, in this lighter mode, last year, the first time in the history, we have a ICAR tableau. And that was an integrated farming. We carried the message of integrated farming, right? And this year, again, we are successful. Mind you, there will be 60 competitors, and there are about 6 to 8 times you have to actually go for presentations and face almost 20 people there, experts. And that is what we did. And again, this time we are selected finally at Tableau. And Tableau is going to come again ICAR and bearing the message Kisan Gandhi. This is 150th years of Gandhiji's birthday and birth anniversary. So Kisan Gandhi, that's the message. Why? You can ask me why. Because Gandhiji underwent training as a farmer for 15 days at our NDRI center in Bangalore. 15 days as a farmer. In fact, somebody said that a leader and all that, he cut it down in his own hand. He said farmer from, you know, whatever. So that's the kind of message. And also he's, kind of liking for dairy farming and then goat, and all that are depicted, and you like it, I hope. So that's the second time consecutively we have competed. And a Republic Day parade and the Rajpath, you will find ICAR Tableau running and rolling and conveying message of Kisan Gandhi. So your animal-based agriculture will be depicted. The milk revolution is depicted. 176 million tons of milk. How many are veterinarians here? So you should take credit and pride in this. So this time our veterinary and animal husbandry is the message, milk production is the message, milk testing would be there, the quality testing of milk will be there, and various other aspects are of course there, so which are related. Organic farming is there, because he visited one organic farming center in Indore, the Institute of Plant Industry, those days, 1935. And there he saw Indore method of composting, that was world famous. Indore method of composting, world famous method. And he went there and looked at it, and that indicated how concerned and passionate Mr. Gandhi was, Gandhiji was for agriculture. So anyway, so that's the kind of message I wanted to give you. But then before I end, friends, what you actually want, what this country want? Somebody said artificial intelligence. So we had a brainstorming and discussion for 2 days at IRI, at NAS, on artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence and blockchain technology and then machine learning, Internet of Things, and all areas were discussed comprehensively. And we are bringing out a document that's there, the rough draft is there, and we'll be releasing shortly. That what all we should be doing. In fact, ICAR should have done this 10 years ago. Somehow we are lagging behind. We initiated some work here and there using artificial neural networks and then utilization of that in some aspects of it. But largely, we have actually not been able to take advantage of this area. So this is so important. And this is what we are going to initiate a mega program on this. ICAR mega program on artificial intelligence and associated technologies, for precision agriculture, for various other purposes, for post-harvest management and various other. So we are actually interacting in a public-private partnership mode. So in fact, in that meeting, we invited IBM, we invited many other partners, and Oracle and Niti Aayog, of course, was there, and No, leave aside institutions. IITs were there and then all those things were there. But I think the private partners were there. So I think, there's plenty of opportunity in that. And there is quite a bit of empty space for all of you to occupy, irrespective of your field of specialization. And, one has to think in that direction, how to really. And yesterday I was in the flight, I was discussing with somebody that how to actually, for instance, I say, and you will be leader if you can work on that. For instance, some of our agriculture engineers are here. Of course, soil water is their specialization. But I was discussing that suppose all our tractors, now driverless tractors have come.
We have farm machinery.
Okay, farm machinery, maybe one person is there, yes. So we say driverless tractors. But can we use solar? Can we use electric vehicles for driving tractors? There is, globally there is, and for past 2 years I have been telling my DDG engineering to actually go move ahead in this direction. We have work, sir, but unfortunately we have not been able to do much, and one need to innovate. How to make it cheaper? At this point, technology is costlier. How to make it cheaper? And I was told that the solar power cannot drive heavy tractors. But can we have technology to do that? This is where we have to innovate. Disruptive innovations. Honorable Prime Minister keeps talking about disruptive innovations. Can we do this? And I can enumerate 20 areas to you where you must innovate. Where you must innovate. You know, my own area, biotechnology, the genome editing, we have not been able to take advantage of this particular area. I am still lost in what I was doing 15 years ago or 10 years ago. When I was writing the Rice Genome Project, none of us knew what is genomics in 1998-99. None of you, neither worked in country, talk about ICAR. Nobody knew, nobody worked in the area of genomics. When I made the first presentation to initiate work under NATP, what should be the genome sequencing work in Buffalo, that was the time of the Buffalo, and also Rice. That is what we planned for. And subsequently, Buffalo was dropped, only Rice retained there. And I made the first presentation when Dr. Mangalarai was DG, Dr. Dillon was ADG, Dr. Mangalarai was a DDG, Dr. Porodu was a DG actually. And that is how Rice Genome Project came. So, thinking ahead of time, when I made the molecular bidding as a program as a student in 1987, as a student in 86, it just started globally. And pick those ideas and build that into a program in the country. And those first papers which I published, and they're the first of kind in the country. Nobody else was working in those days. A first map I published in the country, the genetic map based on RFLP markers. That remained the first one in the country. So you can innovate in ideas and genome editing. There are plenty of scope to edit genes which are so crucial for us in different systems. You have a pig now which is resistant to African swine fever. And such a serious one in Northeast. So likewise, I can keep enumerating. And we keep talking about extension and so on and so forth. And we reach. Last year we did training of 15 lakh farmers. So if you do that, but what is the use of ICT in today's context? Can I reach 14 crore farmers of this country at one go? Can you innovate in that area? Use of ICT. So we are talking with TCS and then working with them. But I believe that individual scientists have a lot more to do and contribute. Not a Gisa Pita, the kind of old track and keep doing something and contributing little, very small step. And the process lose out. We don't really compete with anybody. And IRI, New Year Day, I said that you publish Nature and Science, Dr. Rao was telling. And many people were murmuring, what is this fellow talking Nature and Science? So they are all in slumber. IRI is still doing good. They are all in slumber. They don't want to really wake up and take up this challenge. I believe all of you will take up this challenge. There are plenty of things to talk about. And science communication, the other day I came that you must communicate very well science. How do we communicate science? Unfortunately, scientists do not know how to communicate science. Scientists do not know how to communicate science. We are very poor orators. We are very poor writers. We do not know how to provide a proper perspective to what we are discussing. And that's the reason why we are losing out. And I said that, engage these people in science writing. Give a topic. Let them write. Earlier in ARS, we had essays to be written. I don't know, today there's no essay writing. So give them only 2,000 words, not beyond that. And you can give space. And within that space, and some lines you can draw. And within those, they have to write. And one particular issue, and they, for a popular press, they have to write. Give them assignment. And that should be exam for them. And grade them. And that grade should be added in their, in their initial CR to be written. And that grade should be very important. And this is only one area. I have been talking about every time I come and tell something, And I believe, I strongly believe that you are implementing those. And this could be one area, that how to really communicate to public. And the other is that you are all scientists. If you are given a table of data and some background information, can you interpret? Let them be given an assignment. What is the kind of collation power taking literature into account? And what interpretation they can give, what inferences they can draw, and what is that power? It requires mathematical understanding of things and a mathematical mind to do that. And everybody should have mathematical mind, whether one studied mathematics or not. And if one has that, then there will be proper interpretation coming out. Otherwise, this is my observation, this is lower than that, this is higher than that, and this was observed earlier. That's it. That's the kind of conclusion we draw from the experiments. So your research management to say that how to write a paper and how to write a paper would be successful only when one understands how to interpret it. Interpret the data in the context of, you know, the information which is available. So this is one assignment which should be given to them so that, you know, they work on that. In addition to this, presentations. When I was there, Dr. Manikandan used to take that class at how you should make a presentation. Unfortunately, I see my scientists today who have been trained here do not know how to make slides. One slide, the font size would not be more than 12. It will be 12. And how on earth would read those letters which are 12 or less than 12? So if you have, you know, font size 12, so obviously, so you are not doing a good job. You are not a communicator. So what should be appropriate font size? How many bullets should be there in one? What graphics one has to use to impress? And what kind of inferences you draw, not describing one slide for 20 minutes, but what is that inference you can immediately, you know, mention and have impact? So this need to be actually revisited here so that the communication skills of these people is far better and greater than my existing stuff, where I find that we are so poor. Drafting a letter, I'm painful to see that the letters, the things which come from various institutes and all that places, that will be 20 mistakes. Every line will have a mistake, grammatical and otherwise. And I have to sit and write the letters and the messages and all those and do that, because people have not learned that. And having said that, we should learn Hindi perfectly, all right. Hindi janna chahiye, sikhna chahiye, bolna chahiye. Mujhe Hindi bilkul nahi aati thi jab Delhi aaya main 1985 mein. To ab main National Academy of Science ka program tha Chitrakoot mein. Main gaya ek topic leke ki ancient Indian agriculture through the lenses of modern science. उसमें बहुत सारे श्लोक थे, संस्कृत के चीजें थे, और मैं जैसे गया, मुझे बोले आपको हिंदी में बोलना है. मैं पूरा विज्ञान को हिंदी में बोला वहां सारे चीज. उसके बाद बोले, अरे आप तो बढ़िया हिंदी बोलते हो. मैं बोला, मेरा मातृभाषा नहीं है, मुझे आती नहीं है हिंदी. मैं तो यहीं आके दिल्ली में सीखा. तो सीखना चाहिए, लेकिन एट द सेम टाइम यू डू नॉट हैव एनी राइट टू से दैट आई विल नॉट हैव ए गुड ड्राफ्टिंग एंड लर्निंग ड्राफ्टिंग इन इंग्लिश. As a scientist, you are bound by that. You must know how to write a good draft in English. So, inse ek badhiya letter likhwaiye, message likhwaiye, ek topic dijiye sabko. Let them write message. Sabko alag alag topic de dijiye. Let them write a brief message, one page message. And what should be the content of that message? And likewise, and if they have to build entrepreneurship, if you go back and build entrepreneurship, what is the process to build entrepreneurship? And how do you visualize entrepreneurship building in this country? Because the post-harvest space is very important, entrepreneurship is very important. So I am crossing the limit. There is plenty of things to tell, but this is enough, I believe. So I should stop here and keep doing good work. And above all, you should be good to all human beings, right? So if you are a good human being, then only you can bother for farmers. नहीं तो आप जो है सेल्फिश होके अपने घर पे अपना तनख्वाह मिल गया, अपने बच्चे हैं, बीबी हैं और फिल्म देखना है, आज मॉल जाना है, कल दूसरा मॉल जाना है, तो परसों तीसरा मॉल जाना है, और वहाँ केरला का वहाँ बैक वाटर में वहाँ जाके 5 दिन बिता के आना है, वो सब अच्छा है, वो करना चाहिए, रिलैक्सेशन होना चाहिए, लेकिन ये भी तो कर लीजिए। जो मेन काम है जिसके लिए तनख्वाह मिलता है, सो ये कर्तव्य के साथ साथ मैं हरदम बोलता हूँ त्याग की मनोभाव के साथ काम करना चाहिए। त्याग का भावना नहीं होगा हम कभी किसान के लिए सोच नहीं पाएंगे। किसान के लिए अगर सोचना है, उसके साथ काम करना है, उसके लिए त्याग की आवश्यकता है। अब रिसर्च पेपर पब्लिश करना बहुत अच्छी बात है, बहुत अच्छे जर्नल में, बट साथ साथ हमें सोचना चाहिए मैं कैसे ये आइडिया को ट्रांसलेट करूँगा, किस तरीके से इसको ट्रांसलेट में कर सकता हूँ, तो ये सोचना चाहिए और उसके लिए त्याग की आवश्यकता है। तो ये मैं समझता हूँ आप वो कर्तव्य की जो कर्तव्यबोधता के साथ साथ त्याग की भावना आपके अंदर हो और आप लोग किसान के लिए सोच के काम करें और अपना समय दें। और आप ऐसा नहीं है कि आपको 12 घंटा 16 घंटा मैं दे रहा हूँ अलग बात है, पर आपको देना कोई ज़रूरी नहीं है। बट हाउ इफेक्टिवली आई यूटिलाइज माई टाइम, वट इज द क्वालिटी टाइम आई गिव टू माई रिसर्च, हाउ डीपली आई गेट इन्वॉल्व इन दैट। यू नो मुझे, मैं एक एग्जाम्पल देकर ख़त्म करूँगा। मैं जब समय हो गया ना, पूरा लेट हो गया, ठीक है, ठीक है, ठीक है। सो मुझे 10 बजे जाना था, 10:30 क्रॉस कर गया, बोले ठीक है। तो मैं जब ज्वाइन किया तो मेरे 2 टेक्निकल थे, उसके बाद थोड़ा चेंज हुआ तो टेक्निकल चले गए, मेरे पास प्रोजेक्ट नहीं था, मेरे पास कोई आदमी नहीं था, तो लोग परेशान होते, तो मेरे पास कुछ नहीं था। तो मैं डिसाइडेड 2 थिंग्स, मैं जितना काम किया था उसका पेपर लिखना शुरू किया। अब एक साल में 10-10 पेपर में छापने लगा, इंटरनेशनल जर्नल में, ऑल इंटरनेशनल जर्नल्स। और उसके बाद मैं पहले भी पढ़ाता था, तभी पढ़ाया और जोश के साथ पढ़ाया, 2-2 घंटा 3-3 घंटा पढ़ाया, लोगों से लिया, फीडबैक लिया, अपने का गलतियां ढूंढा, फिर उसको चेंज करने कोशिश किया। जब तक अपना गलतियां कोई ढूंढेगा नहीं, उसमें परिवर्तन नहीं लाएगा, तो उसमें परिवर्तन नहीं हो सकता, कुछ सीख नहीं सकता आदमी। तो ये जरूरी है कि विथ ए ओपन माइंड यू हैव टू बी देयर। मुझे आप 10 चीज़ें लिखो कि मेरा कमियां ढूंढ के मैं उसमें चेंज करने की कोशिश करूँगा, ना कि आपके विंडिक्टिवली आपके ऊपर एक्शन लूँगा। यू कैन राइट टू मी, सही भाई आपका ये गलती है, आपका ये गलती है, ये गलती है, यू कैन राइट टू मी। सो ये अगर सोच है तो इसके साथ आप चेंज हो सकते हो, अपने को परिवर्तन कर सकते हो। अपने को परिवर्तन करके करने से क्या होता है कि देन आप फिर आपको कोई कुछ बोले फर्क नहीं पड़ता, कोई बोलेगा गधा है, कोई बोलेगा अच्छा है, कोई फर्क नहीं पड़ता। You know what you are. If you know what you are, then you do what you want to do and what is right. तो ये right और wrong, इसके बीच में थोड़ा सा differentiation करना जरूरी होता है। उसके लिए थोड़ा अपने सोच को परिवर्तन करना जरूरी है। अच्छे सोच के साथ आप आगे चलिए। और आपको बहुत बहुत बधाई कि आप सब लोग यहाँ इस स्थान पर पहुँचे हैं और सफलता के साथ। और आप जो आए हैं, सर्टनली यू कैन इमेजिन व्हाट कंपटीशन वाज एंड हाउ कॉम्पिटिटिव यू आर। सो ऑब्वियसली आपका सफलता के लिए आपको बधाई देते हैं, और आप यहाँ नार्म में ये जो बैठे हैं उसके लिए आपको बधाई देते हैं, नार्म को बधाई देते हैं। 109 फोकार्स अभी यहाँ चल रहा है और ये लगातार चलता रहता है और सफलतापूर्वक करते हैं, मेहनत करते हैं। इसीलिए डायरेक्टर और सारे जो फैकल्टी मेंबर्स हैं, आप सबको तहे दिल से धन्यवाद देते हैं कि आप अपना समय देकर यहाँ इन लोगों का कैरियर बनाने में लगे हैं, हाथ पकड़कर आगे लेने में। बहुत अच्छी बात है। और आप सबका उज्जवल भविष्य का कामना करते हुए आगे जाकर आप सफल हो और आपके अंदर अंतर्निहित सुप्त शक्ति जो रहा है उसको जागृत करने में आप सफल होंगे। और अंतर्निहित शक्ति जो लैटेंट पोटेंशियल आपके अंदर छिपा हुआ है इसको जब उसका पूर्ण विकास होगा परिप्रकाश होगा मैं समझता हूँ आप एक सफल व्यक्तित्व होके उभरेंगे और देश को और विश्व को नया दिशा देंगे ये उम्मीद के साथ मैं यहाँ समाप्त करता हूँ शुभेच्छा आप सबको एक उज्ज्वल भविष्य के लिए बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद